The paper is about like how humans, how dogs can actually use video calling devices to call their owners. And I'm looking forward to how this might work, and actually also very interested in how you would design interaction in a way, or how you would research this. Talk is going to be presented by Ilyena, so take it away whenever you're ready.
Thank you so much for having me here. I'm Ilyena Hirskyj-Douglas. I'm from the University of Glasgow, and I'm just here presenting my research of forming the dog internet, sort of how do we prototype a dog-to-human video call device that I did with my co-authors from Aalto University, Roosa and Andrés. So my exploration into the sort of dog internet really started sort of 10 years ago when I got my dog, Zach. I noticed he would watch TV, and I thought it would be really wonderful if he could control the device himself. So I started to build all these computer devices for him that allowed him to do things like turn the TV on and off. And I sort of ended up making all these sort of wonderful different technologies through my PhD. But the more I got into this area, the more I started noticing that really more and more technology is being used in our home for dogs, increasingly both for work, such as helping them press buttons or tracking them, to playing games such as electronic food games or things like this. And so with this like huge increase in dog technology, this market is expected to be 20 billion by 2025. It's really been pushed forward by this huge growth in people getting dogs during COVID and during the lockdown. And there's been a lot more of these smart devices developed that allow humans to video call their dogs. So you can see some examples here on the right. However, in many of these devices, a dog doesn't really have any control or choice over when to use these systems. Instead, they're often used in a dog's home, really without their consent. And so I sort of went back and I started to think about all these screen systems and all the systems I made for dogs. And I started to think, if we could make a video call device for a dog that a dog could control themselves, what would they use them for? And so to explore this, I sort of asked the following sort of two questions. You know, what does it look like for a dog to control a video device? And really, how can humans prototype an interactive device with and for dogs? Now, I asked around prototyping because if we're going to build a device that should be used by a dog, so should a dog be involved in this, and we should really build around sort of a dog's requirements. However, as there's currently no sort of clear method on really how to do this, and dogs feedback in, as we know, in very different ways from humans, how they can be involved and have equality in the process is such a large and open question. So when forming technologies for animals, often you want this sort of close relationship with the entity that you're working with. It allows for this sort of a deep understanding that's drawn from the relationship. So when approaching sort of how does the device look like and how can we build devices with dogs, to answer these two questions, what we started doing was we started developing a device that we coined sort of DogPhone for my dog, Zach, who you can see here, and me to video call on the internet. So to begin really forming this device, we, as no one has really sort of looked at how can a dog control the internet before, we sort of came up with these three different stages of prototyping with dogs. And these are sort of to form the shape, to look at the aesthetics, and then to form the interaction paradigm. So this process first looked at sort of how dogs interacted with items in their everyday environment, my dog specifically. We sort of tested various forms of the aesthetics to build the device for the dog, and then developed the software and the hardware for the dog phone prototype from these results. So as I mentioned, we built from sort of the everyday interactions with his objects. And this was really to focus around his affordances and usability around his current items. So for our dog participant, Zach, this include items in the environment, such as sticks and grass and flowers and leaves. And this also included toys such as stuffed toys, balls, and ropes. And we didn't really tend to use any buttons as he didn't have these in his ordinary environment. So drawing from his literature, what we found was that these should really be tangible objects as an interface, as this is more intuitive for dogs. And it also fits with their current affordances and recommendations to use these objects. So we gave Zach new objects of these most preferred devices. So this was, you see here, he's chewing a stick. This was a stuffed toy and also a ball. He mostly chewed the stick initially, and then after this, it was very much shortly abandoned. With the stuffed toy and ball, he would groom and lick both of these. And he would also carry the ball around sort of as a mediator. So both of these items were used really to mediate his relationship with his human. However, he didn't groom and lick the ball so much, so we chose with this ball interface shape. After choosing the ball form, we then wanted to test the aesthetics of things. So we gave the dog first this very much a hard tennis ball and then a softer plastic ball that had more malleability. Aesthetics properties such as texture and materiality have recently been noticed as key factors for animal interfaces. And so again, we gave this two items to the dog for a week and used a human to sort of judge the dog's interactions like we did before to form the shape. And what we found was the dog tended to fetch the tennis ball. He associated this strongly with this behavior. And after initially exploring and chewing the soft interface, he initially abandoned this. And so we went back with the soft hollow ball version. And this was because he had a preference for this in terms of how frequently he played with this, the behavior affordances it has, and also its usage as a mediator between the dog and the human. With this interface chosen, the toy then had to be made into an interactive interface to enable dog phone functionality, you know, that of the dog being able to call the human and the human also to video call the dog. As it's currently really unknown how much a dog can really understand the interaction with computers, many people believe animals are on this sort of continuum of understanding. We wanted something that really required simplistic behaviors. And since the dog moved the ball ordinarily, so he would carry it around in his mouth, as you see in the photo, we used this behavior actually for the interaction technique. So anytime he moved the ball, this would ring the human. If the human answered, they could then decide to hang up. And we did this so that it could safeguard the dog in case, you know, there was any negative behaviors from this or, you know, he displayed anxious behaviors. And so this sort of made the interaction between the dog calling the human. We also, because this is two people in this interaction, both the dog and the human, made it so that the human could call the dog and then the dog could answer by also moving the ball. So it was this ball interface that sort of did the mediator between hanging up and answering. And so this sort of made the two-way interaction and also facilitated this two-way dyadic exchanges. So to enable this, we put hardware inside the ball that detected the orientation and wirelessly broadcasted this to a nearby laptop that was kept at the dog's head height in his main living space. When movement was detected via a Python script, it would trigger an on-call event to start the call. And so in many ways, this ball was sort of an Internet of Thing device, and it could just be charged through the opening of putting a wire inside. The total cost of the device was approximately £30 GB. And the software is open access and GitHub in case anyone is interested in this side of things. We then had to come up with a method to measure how much a dog would use this ball to ring the human and also the human to ring the dog. We used a mixed method approach of combining a diary study along with sort of interpretations from the human side and also measurements of the quantitative interactions of how often and for how long the dog used the ball. The software logged the time and the timing of the call, and the human wrote in the diary of what happened and also took screenshots of the call. We began by introducing our dog to the device. So it was demoed to the dog five times, and these demos lasted between 19 and 146 seconds. And after this, whenever the dog was left alone for long periods of time, over 3 months, the dog was given the ball. So they could video call the human and the human could call them and they could answer. Because of the way the software was developed in a prototype manner, we ended up actually changing the software through three different iterations to change its sensitivity and also how the dog interacted with it. And we did a total of 16 study days over 3 months period. In iteration one, this iteration only lasted 2 days and there was 18 calls in total, so 9 per day, averaging 1 minute each call. But half of these calls were made when the dog was actually asleep with the ball. So my dog would often grab the ball and sort of dream with the ball. So he would trigger the ball like this. The human also called the dog, but he didn't really pick up. And so we concluded from this that the ball was sort of too sensitive and we needed to sort of make it so it wasn't as sensitive to his dreaming behaviors. So what we did was we changed the sensitivity, which formed iteration two, which lasted 7 days. And while initially the dog did use the video call device on the first day, there wasn't any other phone calls through this period. But what the human noticed was that the dog ball had moved inside the home, actually, even though no calls had been triggered. So the ball was not sensitive enough. And so we changed the device again to be between iteration one and iteration two. So by the third and final iteration, this lasted 7 days where 35 calls were made, which averaged a 5 per day and, one by the human on day 15, which also wasn't answered. The human coded all of these calls almost made by accident due to the dog not responding to the video call from the human's perspective. And we don't really know the dog's thoughts or, intentions in this. The dog also often triggered the ball by leaning or lying on the ball with his shoulder or his butt. But due to these continual calls, the human often left the video call on so that the dog could see the environment flipping the camera around. They would show the dog things like the phone camera, the live music, the restaurants, the public transport, people around them. And in many ways, the human sort of became a mediator between the dog and the rest of the world. However, near the end of the study, the human did start to log into the system remotely to view the dog, which caused an increasing sense of anxiety when they couldn't see the dog on the camera. So what did we find from this work? Well, as this is a sort of a case study in itself, the findings really have usage across sort of two areas on sort of what do computers look like for remote interactions and how can humans prototype interactive video call devices with dogs. So for dogs' interactions with video call devices, what we found was that they vary daily for really sort of unknown reasons. You know, it's impossible to really for us to know if a dog used the system intentionally or what associations DogPhone had for the dog. And we suspect that this initial demo phase was really not long enough or simple enough to really establish a connection for the dog and is really a key area of future work. And what I would say is also sort of the hardest step in making these animal interfaces is really finding an understandable triggering mechanism for dogs. And so we tried to use items that were familiar to dogs, but more work is really needed to understand how we transform these systems from everyday items into Internet of Things systems. We also noticed that the approach of classifying whether they were interested in the call or it was accidental is a valid and often used approach, but it's really unclear in our context, what does an accidental or even what's an interaction mean for a dog using a computer system? These terms are very much HDI ones applied to animals, and because our viewpoint on the world is sort of biased by our humanness, I guess you would say, about what we see as intent and what we define as interaction and interactive behavior, while the dog had these accidental calls, such as leaning on it with his butt or with his shoulder, this could also have been purposeful interaction. We don't know. It could be argued that the dog could have just avoided the device, but then this also opens up questions of how can we really define and see interaction with animals? And I would put forward that perhaps there's more terminology needed here beyond these sort of typical words. Aside from this, part of the process was also exploring how the Internet of Things can support a dog and a human's relationship. While initially, during the first call, the dog did whine, so shown a little sign of distress, the dog's human in the later calls had more anxiety. And additionally, the dog also never answered the human's call. And so there's this difference in behavior between the dog and the human, but within one system. So it really highlights that future work really needs to uncover and sort of manage how we behave with these different stakeholders. One of the key contributions of the study was also to investigate the design process with the dogs. Working with animals is, challenging because we don't always understand about dogs and computers, and the process of unraveling sort of the requirements of what is a dog and what is a need and what is a goal between the dog and the human becomes sort of near impossible when we have this dog-human interface. And so part of this process is really acknowledging that while we aim to make this sort of dog-centric and dog-focused device, the human is involved inherently as a builder, a coder, a designer, and an interpreter. It's also unclear how empowering this system was, because to be empowered implies that there's some understanding from the dog of what's going on. And so if the dog doesn't understand what's going on, it could be argued that the dog can't really consent to such a system. And so we really highlight this as a future key area. The dog's longest calls were also where the human was showing them other things than themselves, such as the environment, which opens up possibilities to dog-human environment video calling. However, what our study really does show, and what I think is the key takeaway, is that dogs can really be active users of the systems. They can really control the video system in their own home. And while we aimed for this and we put in things like equality and empowerment so the dog could choose, and we tried to include our dog in the approach, it's really still questionable if we can really design for and with dogs who have very different cognitive and biological need. As such, I think we approach this in very much a HCI standpoint, but its approach itself really highlights that we need to think how we implement Internet of Things devices for animals to give them this control. Here, we're forced to see how would and could a dog use a system, which reshapes our thinking and opens up new possibilities of what a dog would look like when using an internet system to access the internet. So in summary, we used a smart system in the home for humans to video call their companion animals, but typically animals have no controls over these systems. In response, we developed DogPhone, an Internet of Things device that facilitates a dog video and calling their human. And we gave insights in how to develop, prototype, and create technologies with animals that they can control. And through this, we raise critical questions of how to manage a dog's interactions, how we quantify these, and how we can form devices and what they mean for dogs. So I'd like to thank you for listening, and to my co-authors for supporting my crazy ideas of creating dog internet devices, and also to my lovely dog, Zach, who really inspires me to be a better person and create these devices together. You can follow my research on Twitter or contact me via email. I also have recently started a group at the University of Glasgow in animal-computer interaction and be looking for PhD students. So if you want to form the future of the dog internet, please get in touch.
Thank you very much, Ilyena. There are no questions in the audience and online. I have just a brief question because we're really running short on time now. And you mentioned this accidental versus interaction. Like, do we actually know that the dog wanted to interact? And I think you also mentioned this in your paper as well. If you now reflect on this, how you approach the idea from a research methodology, and could you just briefly comment on this in retrospective? Would you change something, or would you like argue that this is a good way of prototyping these devices? Just what's your comment on this?
I think the way that I prototype is probably the best way that I can see currently at the moment of testing these different devices. It would be interesting, I think. It's so confusing, you know. I think we should really just give dogs the options of choosing and being able to choose these different devices to see what would a dog. You have this sort of tension here where you don't want to put too much of what you think is good and into this, and you sort of try to, as I sort of gave my dog choices through the prototyping phase, to give him power in it. And so I would really encourage other people to sort of, you know, build off my method to really discover what works for their dogs, and then what works for different dogs or different animals. And then we can hopefully start forming different ways and sort of form the foundation of how to build devices with and for dogs.
Thank you very much, Ilyena, for these insights. Okay, I think this concludes our session. Thank you very much to all the authors again. Thank you for being here. Thank you for everyone in the audience. We will resume at 30 minutes past one. Right, so 1:30, we will resume with the keynote over here. There's lunch in the room next door. See you then.